And welcome to Sports on Tap. I'm your host, Rob Trevin. We have Sean Duffy here in the RRT production studios here in North Ridgeville. Sean Duffy and Josh Jeffy out on assignment right now, although Ed will join us here in a little bit. You can catch us at SOT Podcast on Twitter, and also catch us on Facebook. We're Sports on Tap Podcast.com. We're on YouTube where we archive all of our shows. And first off, want you to thank and enjoy our sponsors. G&G Fitness. We've worked with them on a coach of the week that we'll get more involved with as the football season comes around in August. The coach of the week, if you have a high school coach or a summer coach and you want to nominate them for our coach of the week, go to livefit.com where you can nominate your coach there. Someone who's worked hard and you know, done great things that you respect and enjoy and would just like to be a part of it or like to have them recognized. That's G&G Fitness. Want to thank them for being a loyal sponsor. Also, want to thank RRT Productions for being a sponsor here on Sports on Tap. Z's Cream and Bean. You want some good ice cream, go out to Hinckley, Ohio, where Z's is, and they have some great ice cream, milkshakes, and all kinds of goodies for you to enjoy this summer. 2706 Boston Road in Hinckley. You can find Z's Cream and Bean. We'll be out there again sometime soon for high school football and our preview show out there in August. And our newest, actually, we're working with GV Artwork. I have about 10 of their t-shirts, just a great company we enjoy. All of us guys here at Sports on Tap have all kinds of t-shirts of theirs, great designs from Cleveland. You know, they have a location in Lakewood. Visit that store. It's beautiful. All kinds of different shirts, sweatshirts, and apparel there. Cleveland and all kinds of others, actually. So go check them out. They have colleges as well. If you like the college scene, go there and check them out. All you have to do, though, if you want some money off, on tap 10, and you'll get 10% off your order when you order online. That's GV Artwork, located in Lakewood. Want to thank them also for being a part of our show. And go to sportsontappodcast.com for all these sponsors. You can click on them and it'll go right to their website. So we'll get into the NBA draft. And Ed Dick will talk to us here in a sec as we get him on to talk a little basketball. And guys, thanks for joining us. And let's get right into it, guys. Thoughts on the NBA draft and what's going to happen here tonight.
Just as an update, the second pick was made. It was Ja Morant. He went to the Memphis Grizzlies. Right now the Knicks are on the clock, but we're coming closer to the fifth pick where the Cavs, and let's assume for argument's sake, the Cavs stay at number five. Do you think there's a position of need that they need to address, or is it just strictly best player available no matter what position?
I think it's best player available. If it's a point guard that or someone that's going to mesh well with Colin Sexton in the backcourt, a la C.J. McCollum and Damian Lillard in Portland, so be it. If it's a 3D guy, great. I think it's best player available. I don't think there's a specific position that they're going to go in and say, I have to get someone here, and I'm going to reach to do it. I think Kobe Altman is I don't think Kobe Altman would do that.
Yeah, I think I agree completely. I mean, at this point in time, you have to take the absolute best player, you know, out there. I mean, this Cavs team needs young players with a lot of talent. And if it's another guard, I mean, you can match him up with Colin Sexton, whether Colin Sexton is bringing the ball up or, you know, if you draft a point guard or a shooting guard, they can bring the ball up and do some different roles there. I think overall you just need a guy that is the most talented guy on the board. I mean, obviously you can go for position all day long, but the Cavs have so many needs. You know, I just think that you got to go with the best available at this point. And hopefully You know, you could build around a few players. And Colin Sexton obviously would be one of them. You know, Clarkson had a great year of scoring last year, I thought, for the Cavs. But, you know, his contract's up, I believe, after next season. You know, he could maybe be a trade piece at one point. But you need a few young guys, really, to build around here.
I agree with you, Rob, in the sense that I think you could take best player available. But I really do also think, you know, there's something to be said about, you know, going after the best player that fits your scheme. And we're not sure what kind of offense John Bielema wants to run. I mean, I've seen what he does in Michigan. It's pass oriented. So I'm not sure if he targets that or if it's anything that he looks at. But, you know, I'm afraid of getting best player available because I think that's what we fell into the trap with Anthony Bennett. He was just a hands down best player, but he didn't necessarily fit anything we were doing at the time. We just kind of picked him because, again, we had the number one pick and he was the best player on the board. But, you know, again, maybe you're at the number one pick, you're trapped into that a little bit because, you know, they are the best player. Not to say that, you know, obviously LeBron James worked out. It works out more than it doesn't. But I think when you're at number five and there's literally now the best three players in this draft, hands down, are gone, you know, is there really a reach to say, look, I know this guard is listed as, you know, Jay's number five pick, but maybe we need a forward. We need somebody, a stretch four. We need somebody that can, you know, that can, or a wing that can, you know, shoot the three and play defense. I think maybe they look at that and they say, you know, let's do that. And maybe they look at a guy like Cam Reddish, who's, you know, again, unpolished, certainly, maybe inconsistent. But again, he had to share one basketball with two guys that went one and now number three to the Knicks. So I don't know if it's necessarily everyone's down on Cam Reddish because he's inconsistent. Well, I mean, he played at Duke with the top three guys
RG
in the
Barrett
draft. So I mean, it's tough to really put a lot on Cam Reddish. Plus, we don't know what the dynamic was. Maybe he didn't like the ball. Who knows? But I don't know if best available is. I think we really at five. My opinion would be
who's your selection here at five? I mean, we're at the Lakers next at number four is RJ Barrett, a shooting guard out of Duke. Went 22.6.
Number four is the Hawks.
Well, it's still the Lakers until the trade is official.
But the rights go to the Hawks, so really it's the Hawks making the pick.
Unfortunately, because it'll probably be DeAndre Hunter who they're targeting here. We'll wait on
Or that Texas Tech guard. I'm not sure. One of those two.
Culver.
I think Culver's maybe coming off because I think the Hawks need a true.
Well, they could go with what's his name, who had a heck of a year, and now my mind went blank. What's his name? Ed, do you remember his name out of he was, I believe, what was it? What's his
Sean
name?
Sean Duffy.
Yeah.
Hey, yeah. Do you remember that guy who played the ball and did the thing? Rob's really being descriptive on the phone to you right now.
Guy.
Yeah, that guy. He's a really good guy. You know, a lot of heart. That guy.
I'll find out. My mind went blank.
But I mean, Ed, it's interesting to see where the Cavs are because, you know, everyone's like, well, we're post LeBron 2 years, and you know, Colin Sexton improved over the year, and no one can question that guy's work ethic. He's an Iron Man, played 82 games. You know, is your job as the GM, as Kobe Altman, I wonder if he's looking to find a compliment to Colin Sexton. Do we need that compliment? Do you think that's the formula that works, you know, as it did in Portland, or even, you know, obviously worked very well in Golden State, but is that the formula that the Cavs are going to have to follow now? Because, I mean, obviously free agency isn't going to be something that we're going to be looking forward to going forward.
I think Altman has had very detailed discussions with Beeline about what they want to do and what the various scenarios that they potentially play out. And I think it'll just, you know, by process of elimination, you know, I would assume Hunter's not going to be there, so that's going to be a ship that's not out there available. So it is going to come down to most likely the three gentlemen we talked about earlier. There could be a fourth I'm just not aware of. Maybe it's the guy from College University that Rob was trying to talk about. It's I think the Beeline will be able to make it work either way. The guy's got about 40 years of experience as a head coach, and he's seen pretty much everything out there. Now, he's going to be going to this thinking that, you know, I need a specific guy. It's probably, I think this going to be best player. I still think it's going to be best player available. And, you know, after they run through the scenarios, we'll make the pick off of that. And then we'll see what happens, whether it's another guard or if it's a 3-and-D. I think either way it's going to work.
Yeah, I think John Beeline, like you said, Ed, I think he has – players that he wants. He's going to have a lot of say, I think, in some of these picks. You know, the Cavs have two picks, one going here next, coming up soon here as the pick is in. And the Lakers are
Cavs
still
are
on the board, but the Cavs, yeah, will be on the clock. And after the Cavs pick, we'll take a short break here. But, you know, so far it's been Zion Williamson who's number one. John Morant at number two went to Memphis, and R.J. Barrett is headed to New York. And actually, the two Duke players have cried so far in this draft. So, you know, they're obviously excited to be in the NBA. And it's going to be interesting to see with the bright lights for R.J. Barrett in New York.
What are you trying to insinuate that you're a Duke fan, you're saying these two Duke players are crying? Are you saying they're not men, Rob?
No,
I'm
saying it's okay to cry, Sean Duffy.
I think what you're saying is that Duke basketball players are a bunch of whiners and criers. I think that's what you're trying to say. And I think you're just trying to like make me say it out loud.
Well,
so
I think you're wrong.
Really? Because you brought it up. I didn't.
I know. I'm just telling you. I'm telling you the emotion.
We didn't bring up the fact that Zion Williamson is dressed like he's in a Bone Thugs and Harmony video circa 1997. But
nothing wrong with that. Nothing wrong with that. As right now, you know, they have the Lakers pick in, and it will be for the Atlanta Hawks who made the trade up to get their guy. And we'll see who their guy is here shortly. As they gave away the 8th pick, the 17th pick, and the 35th. And that's a pretty nice trade. And you know what I was thinking of? Trae Young from Atlanta. So Trae Young of Atlanta, who had a heck of a rookie season last year.
He did.
You know, for the Hawks. You know, that's what I think, you know, it doesn't ever hurt to, you know, have two good point guards. And I know Trae Young was a guy who brought it up, but shot from anywhere on the floor, and he reminds me a lot of Steph Curry in that aspect. So I'll be interested to see what they do. But Trae Young is the guy from Atlanta, the point guard who had a heck of a rookie season last year, who I was thinking about there. So
now remember, the Cavaliers still have another pick in this round. They have two first round picks. One of them right now at number 5, and then at 26. So
right. You're
coming out of here with first round talent. But again, to our viewers, the talent pool tends to kind of dry up around 20. You get some good players, you know, 20 through probably the end of the first round. But, you know, the top, obviously the cream of the crop, I think, in most drafts is in the top 20. And this one, I think, is really the top 15. Once the top 15 players are gone, you're really kind of, you know, having a hard time selling, I think, a lot of fan bases on coming out just for that guy. But it works sometimes. But a lot of these teams who are 20 and back usually are the teams that are better and have, you know, better records and have maybe a more core developed or established, a la your Golden States, your Torontos, your Houston. Well, as much as Houston's core is still
Houston,
around.
There was a rumor out there that Houston tried to ship Chris Paul to the New York Knicks, and I believe that probably could have been for you know, one of the third pick overall, and the Knicks turned it down. So that's kind of interesting. But yeah, we're still waiting for the Lakers as they're at a commercial break right now. When they come back, I'm sure the Lakers will have a pick. But do you? What's your feeling? Who do you think the Cavs will take with their pick as it comes up?
I will respectfully make said pick, and then I'm going to get off the line here.
Yeah,
and, I just get home, and my son's hanging out with my wife, so I think they're going to go, provided Jared Culver's still there, I think they're going to go with Jared Culver from Texas Tech.
All right, okay. Put it on the board, Rob. Ed thinks Garrett Culver, Texas Tech, will be a Cavalier within the next 10 minutes. It's on the board, Ed. If you're wrong, you owe me $50. Okay. All right, fine.
Hey, Ed, thanks $20. For calling us, and we'll look forward to seeing you soon, bud. Thanks for joining us tonight.
Thank you, I appreciate it. Thanks, guys. Obviously, we have some big stuff coming up here in the next couple of months. So stay tuned, everybody. Things are going to be heating up here, hopefully, both literally and metaphorically.
All right.
Absolutely. And actually, the pick is in, and it is DeAndre Hunter.
DeAndre Hunter went to the Hawks.
There it is. All right. Thanks, Ed. Appreciate it.
All right. Have a good one, guys.
You too. All right, now the Cavs are on the clock. Shaw Duffy.
It's go time, baby. It's go time. Cavs on the clock. Probably pick is in. Kobe Altman probably tapping on his glasses. John Beilein had to go to the bathroom for the 15th time.
Wait, you kind of sound like Bill Walton right now. This is unbelievable.
What are you talking about? I love basketball.
No, now you don't, but you actually kind of did sound like Bill Walton there. And that's, you know, I was looking forward to DeAndre Hunter being a Cav. Well, the Cavs have some choices here to make. Are they trying to work a trade now to move down? Are they going to stay there?
Where are the phones? Because now you got a guy like, now you have all three point guards in play. And the team that I think maybe on the outside looking in and maybe miss out on a top-tier point guard is the Bulls at 7.
See, now here's Hunter, and they're showing some highlights of him, and you know, he's got a good mid-range jumper. He can shoot the three, defensive player of the year.
Yeah, that's
you know, he had over 15 a game last year for Virginia, who had a very, very good year. And you know, you could...
Well, they won a national championship, so that's a
exactly.
Great
that's what I mean, after losing in the first round. But, I mean, that's a player that's so valuable when he can be that stretch guy to play defense, but then he gives you the offense. You know, he almost reminds me a little bit of, like, and I think he's way more athletic than Al Horford, but he reminds me of an Al Horford type of player where he can shoot that three, but he can also get in the paint and mix it up a little bit. That's who I would compare him to. Now, you look at Chauncey Billups, he's comparing him to Jay Crowder, which Crowder's not a bad player, but...
Jay Crowder is an underrated two-way player. He's an underrated two-way. He's not going to blow you away with stats as far as points scored, but he's also not gonna allow you to beat him off the board. He's a very intense player, but I think DeAndre Hunter has a little bit more offensive skill than that, and he's gonna be a good addition to the Atlanta Hawks, obviously.
And I think you're looking at. I mean, there are some Kobe Whites there from North Carolina.
Let me ask you this,
point
Rob.
Guard.
If the Cavs were to go and say, let's take a Cam Reddish here. Are you upset? Given who's not currently available on the board, Kobe White, Culver, Garland, and then ranked.
Yeah, it's tough. I think Reddish has a lot of upside, and I think, you know, maybe playing.
Is there really a drawback to picking a guy with upside right now? No one's expecting you to win.
I mean, that's the thing. I mean, it's in this draft. I mean, the first three are guaranteed. Everybody says the first three are guaranteed, and I don't know if they are guaranteed. You never know what can happen. But I don't think it would be a bad thing to take a Cam Reddish. You know, I don't have a problem with them picking Cam Reddish here. I mean, if they traded down and still were able to get Cam Reddish, that would be a win because then you get some more picks.
Here's my question. Do they have to get a Do they have to get a –
Wow.
Yeah, I know.
It's that exciting here.
I blew all my energy in the beginning. Do they have to get a solid player – in any trade, like if they trade back, they're gonna have to get somebody. They're gonna have to get a player that's like got to be under some sort of control. They're not trading back for essentially a rental because there's no rental out there like Kawhi Leonard right now. That anyone's gonna trade, not to the Cavaliers.
Yeah,
for five.
Right.
So, is it important to get picks if they trade, or is it important to get a player?
That's the thing. I think they'd probably go for draft picks because I think they're looking to build through the draft here. I think you have to start with some young talent and really build from the ground up. I mean, they have They still have a lot, you know, yeah, Tristan Thompson and veterans, but I think you're going to see J.R. Smith eventually get traded to your
Smith,
team.
J.R. Smith is as good as traded can be at this
point.
Yeah,
I mean,
his contract's
you're not going to get
too
much.
Friendly. In fact, if they're trying to make a trade right now, they're sending J.R.'s contract because it's that coveted, I would imagine, in the NBA because it's an expiring contract. It relieves cap space, you know. They can't wait till Tristan Thompson's contract comes off the books. I mean, I think in like 2 years, they're well under the cap and they can actually afford a max slot at that point.
Yeah.
And you wonder what's going to happen in 2 years with Colin Sexton, whoever they draft tonight.
I mean, what would you do if somebody offered something for Kevin Love? I mean, if they offered a good young player that could step in right now and be impressive and you get some draft picks. Because right now the pick is in from the Cavs, who almost took all of their 4 minutes, which the first three, the pick was in almost immediately. So you wonder if they were going back and forth trying to make trades at this point in time.
I wonder. We'll see.
Or, yeah, there's still 40 seconds left on the clock, but the Cavs
pick is in according to
ESPN, as they try to – and it looks like Chauncey's wearing – a nice wine and gold jacket, it almost looked like. Let's see, who's this pick going to be here? This is going to be interesting with the Cleveland Cavaliers. Do they go guard? Do they go shooting guard? Which way do they go here? And it looks like – and Darius Garland, before he got injured, he only played 5 games. He did average over 16 points a game for Vanderbilt and was really impressive and probably – could have been one of the top picks. He was actually the top-rated point guard before Ja Morant, before he got injured. He tore his meniscus. It was the injury. So
yeah.
The pick is in Sean Duffy. And
I'm so nervous.
Here
we go.
Here is the pick for the Cleveland Cavaliers, round one, number 5 here in the 2019 draft.
And the pick is Darius Garland, point guard from Vanderbilt. Wow.
And I'll tell you, the only thing, you know, he only played 5 games, yeah. And Darius Garland is your selection.
Also dressed like an extra. Looks like he's wearing a robe.
Yeah, it almost looks like a robe.
Darius Garland also just back from Jedi training school.
And his father, Winston, played. He's a 4-time Tennessee High School state champion. And his favorite player is Damian Lillard. I'm sure that's who his game, he would like to say his game is off of. And an interesting pick there. And to me, a little bit risky. Only played 5 games, but they said, hey, do you know what? Remember a guy named Kyrie Irving only played a handful of games at Duke.
And very good point.
And he was the number one pick. So he had 16.2 points a game, 54% field goal percentage, and 3.8 assists per game in only 5 games for Vandy. And that's the thing, you know, a lot of the talent that he, you know, that they played, you know, was it impressive in games 1 through 5? They're showing you right now.
I mean, he's got a great shooting stroke. He's obviously listed as a pure shooter. My concern is, obviously, we have a guy like, you know, he likes to have the ball, in his hand. And I don't know if I don't know this for a fact. I'm hoping this isn't a Deion Waiters, Kyrie Irving type situation where they wanted to put that together.
And I think, you know, he has a lot of talent, and you know it's there. But, boy, it's, you know, only playing 5 games. Now you put a nice guard around him, around Colin Sexton and Jarrett Culver, and we'll see what happens. Or Darius Garland, what am I saying? Culver's still on the board here.
Yeah,
as the Suns are up at number 6.
Who are you drafting right now?
Yeah, Darius Garland was the 5th pick out of Vanderbilt. Like you said, only played 5 games, but, you know, according to scouts out there, he is an elite ball handler, pure shooter. You know, could he be a Steph Curry kind of guy that, you know, he looks like he can shoot anywhere on the floor, which is always exciting to see. So Colin Sexton, maybe that could open some things up for him. But these two guys, the one thing I'm excited about is Darius is a guy that I think could complement Colin Sexton pretty well here. So it's going to be interesting to see, you know, if they don't get it right. You know, this is going to be a tough one, you know, to take a chance, especially, you know, where the Cavs are at right now. But, you know, you got to respect the pick.
We'll see what happens. You never know. This could be one of those where they pick them and now they trade them. Who knows? But we're going to go ahead and step away for a little bit.
Yeah, we'll take a short break.
Short break. Come back. We'll kind of pivot away from in the NBA draft. We'll keep you updated as best we can if any major things happen. But we're going to kind of discuss some baseball, some Major League Baseball,
Let's do.
That I have for Rob, the biggest Indian fan I know.
Before we take a break, did you catch the Tigers-Indian series?
I did catch the Tigers-Indian series.
Wasn't it fun?
It was okay, you better win. We'll talk about that later. We'll talk about that when we come back from our break. This is Sports on Tap, and Rob's a complete homer.
Welcome back to Sports on Tap. I'm your host, Rob Trevin. We have Sean Duffy alongside me here in the RRT Production Studios. It's the NBA Draft 2019. The Cavaliers picked Darius Garland.
Yep.
And out of Vanderbilt, the point guard. And since then, Coby White, a point guard out of North Carolina, went. Jarrett Culver went.
Yep.
To Minnesota.
Not in that order. Culver went to the
Suns. Culver went first.
Who traded their pick to the Timberwolves. And Coby White was just selected by the Chicago Bulls. But, Rob, we're going to shift here on Sports on Tap. We'd like to be an all-around podcast. Tonight's not just about the NBA draft because, well, the Cavs are terrible. And let's move on to a team in Cleveland that, not terrible, but not as good as advertised, I would say, and that's your Cleveland Indians. Now, I know what you're going to say, Rob, and I know what you're going to talk about. You're going to say the Indians swept the Tigers last weekend, and they're about to sweep them again this weekend. Well, there's a couple things I'd like to bring up. The Tigers are a dumpster fire. You're basically beating up on a kid who has a broken leg in the jungle that is the AL Central. You're supposed to beat the Detroit Tigers. You're supposed to beat the Texas Rangers. You're supposed to beat teams like the Royals and teams like the Padres. You're supposed to beat those teams, Rob.
Yeah, you're darn right.
My concern is, one, are the Indians, in your mind, as it sits right now on June 20th, 2019, a legit contender for a playoff spot in the American League?
As of right now, I think they're still a contender.
Very, very different. Very different question. I want you to understand my question. Do you think, as of right now, that the Indians have what it takes, as they're currently constructed, to be a playoff team?
I think so.
Okay.
I mean, we'll see what happens. They've had an up and down year, but the young guys that you said needed to step up.
To bring that up.
Have actually done a pretty decent job right now. And
your boy here, Sean Duffy, said this about your Cleveland Indians not 3 weeks ago when we were having this more than 3 weeks ago, our last show we were having this conversation. You were yelling at me, why are we letting these younger guys, giving the guys time? And now they're in the middle of a very good stretch. They are doing very well with younger players. A guy like Jake Bowers, who came out of nowhere, hit for the cycle against my Tigers. But still, you have guys like...
But he's also batting .220 right now. That's
with how many at-bats? He's only been called up for 2 weeks.
No, Jake Bowers has started since day one, actually.
Okay, but again, he was terrible. Now he's playing better, right?
He is playing better. I think the problem that I still had is... I mean, and I like that, you know, the younger guys are stepping in and doing a decent job. The thing I was saying was when you have as good a pitching as the Indians have, and they have a good pitching staff. Yes, they are injured.
You have when healthy, you have probably one of the
best
pitchers.
When healthy, because there are injuries and things going on right now. But you know, you have a lot of you had some veteran players. You could have kept a Michael Brantley who's having a heck of a year. You know, like now's not necessarily the time to be trying out young guys in your lineup, and I mean it's still early. Now they are getting better, and the offense is putting up more runs now. There's no doubt they split with Texas this recent series, and they've been winning series 2 out of 3, 3 out of 4. I think they've won 11 out of their last 15 games
against teams that are under 500.
Absolutely not.
Really?
They. I think took 3 out of 4 against Boston. They have beaten teams that are actually pretty good. I mean, Boston was one. They beat the Twins in another series. They actually went 2-2 with Tampa Bay. They I think won 2 out of 3 against Houston. Who are some other teams recently?
Well, my point is, okay.
The Yankees, they won, I think, 3 out of 4 or at least 2 out of 3 in that series. So
okay.
There have been some quality wins here. They haven't been against the bottom because you have to beat those bottom teams.
Right. And that's a very good point. And I want to stop you right there. I never said that they're not winning quality wins. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying right now – we're lulled, and I think maybe my point is, and again, a better question to ask you, Rob, is not whether they're going to be a contender, because they very well are right now. They're in the contention for a wild card spot. I don't see them catching the Twins right now. The Twins are, unless there's a catastrophic.
They're on fire. I mean, they're continually playing well.
Unless there's some unforeseen catastrophic failure, which we've seen from the Twins in recent years, the Indians need to have, you know what I mean? It has to be one of those things where the Indians need to have just a crazy run. And the Twins just need to have a run of bad luck. And I think it's the opposite side right now. But I think the question is, Rob, is we're coming up on the trade deadline. We're a little over a month away from the trade deadline. Do you think the Indians are buyers or sellers at the trade deadline?
Well, that's what I'm interested to see in what the front office is going to do. I mean, do you trade a guy? Everybody's talking about trading Trevor Bauer and getting Clint Frazier back from the Yankees, who's a good outfielder. He hasn't made the Yankees – starting lineup in a long time. Yeah, he could be good, but for a Trevor Bauer, I mean, Trevor Bauer is still a good pitcher. I mean, yeah, he had a little bit of a rough few weeks where he wasn't pitching great, but he's still a really good pitcher, and I think a lot of teams are going to want him. People are saying, you know, trade Brad Hand. He's probably the best closer in baseball right now, who's been solid, he has a low ERA. Everybody's trying to get a guy that can save games for him. I mean, the Red Sox would be one. The Cubs, you know, they just, I think, got Kim. Did they get Kimbrel? I thought they did.
I think so.
But, I mean, there's a lot of teams that want guys that can close games, and the Indians have that, and they're still somewhat making a push here where they're winning series. And if you continue to win series, if the Twins continue to win, I mean, they deserve to win the Central. I mean, they have continually been playing at a high level, and they've been winning a lot of games. The Indians have, too. I think the Twins have lost 2 out of 3 to Boston recently, so, you know, maybe the Indians are at 10 games now with the Twins. But, you know, the Twins are playing good ball. But if the Indians continue to win, maybe something, you know, maybe something can happen here. But you know, you got to keep playing. It's still early where I don't know if they're buyers or sellers yet. I mean, to me, I still think they need a bat in that lineup, and they probably can use some relief help, maybe even another starting pitcher. But, you know, they still need some things. They have good pitching, and they're deep in pitching, and they have good young talent. Bobby Bradley's a guy at AAA who has 24 home runs. You know,
so
why not try
hearing about Bobby Bradley, bring him up or trade him. I don't care.
Yeah. I would say try him because Martin right now is struggling. I mean, he's batting 200. Jake Bowers has struggled with his batting edge. He's coming on though a little bit. So why not, you know, keep him in the lineup and see what he continually can do because he has gotten a little bit hot, as Jake Bowers in the outfield. His defense isn't amazing out there, but, you know, the talent they have in the outfield isn't bad. I mean, Ludlow has done pretty good out there. He's hitting for average. My mind's going blank on the other young guy who's actually leading the team in batting average right now, and he's
Mercado?
Mercado has done really well so far. I mean, he's going to be in the lineup, but you know, let's wait and see what happens. You got to try these guys, but why not bring another young guy up who might add some pop to your lineup? But right now, you know, I would say they're to me they're still in the hunt for the playoffs. I would think it's going to be tough. You know, I think Boston and some of these teams could get hot, although the Twins are right now the hottest team probably in baseball. So if they don't lose some games, and I mean, there's a lot of season left, if they keep playing at this high level, I mean, you might not have a chance to catch them, but it's, like I said, you have a lot of in-division games, so it can go either way. But right now, I would think the Indians are still right there and still in it.
Here's why I asked that question, Robin. It's a very important question. And the reason I'm glad you brought up, what's his name,
Bobby Bradley.
Bobby Bradley. It perplexes me, as someone who's not, and I'm very adamant about this, it perplexes me why they haven't brought this guy up. He's leading the
International
League. Me too. And I wonder if it's not, if it's because, one, they are having success with Mercado. Number two, they want to give Leonis Martin as much time as possible. But given the injuries coming off of, we're not sure where he's at. Secondly, maybe it's to protect his value. Think about this. If you bring out Bobby Bradley now, at the height, right before the trade deadline where he's hot right now, and he fizzles, which we've seen happen to a lot of prospects, Now you're stuck because now you can't really package him to get big picks. The same way, as far as Bauer's concerned, I think Bauer's being traded is a foregone conclusion. I think right now, if he has another 1, 2, 3 good outings before the trade deadline, he may be one of those guys that you can get a lot for at the trade deadline rather than in the winter. You see what I'm saying? A guy like Brad Hand, I'm in agreement with you, but again, you just kind of made the case for why to trade him. He's so valuable to a lot of teams. Teams will overpay in Major League Baseball. They do all the time. So why not, if you're gonna trade a guy like Brad Hand, who's by all means one of the best closers in baseball right now, and you got that trade, and you don't have him under control for lose control of him after this year or next season. Why not trade him and get the most you can? Get young prospects, because the way this team is constructed, they're not going to be big players in free agency. They don't have the cash flow for it. You know, they're obviously leaning on young guys to a certain extent to kind of build this core. You know, at some point you're going to have to pay Frankie Lindor, and I don't know what you do there. You know what I'm saying? Kluber is injured until August. You're not getting him back until at best August. You know, there's a lot of moving parts here it's perplexing why you don't bring up a guy like Bobby Bradley, but maybe it is because they're going to be shopping him come the trade deadline. And he's a nice prospect who's on the cusp of making a major league debut that could easily force a team to say, look, we'll give you our top prospects and maybe a bat or an outfielder or somebody, because, you know, I also think that right now you're in a good spot as far as the Indians are concerned, where you're producing finally offensively. You're producing runs. You know, you may not be winning games, maybe in a couple of shootouts here and there. Your pitchers have had Bieber today had a rough first inning and gave up a lot of runs. But, you know, at the end of the day, as long as you can consistently put out as far as, you know, offense is concerned, you have an opportunity. You have an opportunity to win games, and that's all I think. And finally they're coming to that point. I just don't know why they're not bringing that guy up. I mean, if you could put him, he's an outfielder, right? Bobby Bradley?
Yes, he is.
So you could have potentially him, Mercado in the outfield, and,
yeah,
you know, realistically, who's your other outfielder?
You could have Jordan Luplo, or, you know, Jake Bowers is there, or that's who they have, Leonis Martin. And that's why it's a great story, and I want it to work out for him. But, I mean, he has been in a hitting slump since – I mean, he's batting 200, maybe even less now.
Yeah.
So, you know, he needs to get consistent
And, you know, at some point, I mean, Bowers has started to come on. That's why I'd give him more of a chance and maybe –
Yeah, but, I mean, Bowers has come on, and he's definitely done well.
In the month of June, he's batting over 300.
Okay, that's great. And
yeah.
You wonder, again, who – and it's against quality pitching. I mean, he's gone up against a lot of quality pitching. But you wonder, is that sustainable? I mean – you take the chance, you roll the dice and say, look, I want a young outfield. And if you can do that, and if you have players that are in the young outfield that can produce in your lineup, I think you're in a good spot there, because now you have, you know, your veteran hitters like, you know, Carlos Santana and Jose Ramirez, who have been in this situation before and usually find their way out. Now you got these young guys on top of Frankie Lindor who can kind of pick up the slack. I think you have an opportunity to make a run there. But again, you don't know. It's not a clear path to me what the Indians are doing. It's perplexing with their young core. If they're truly going young, then they should just bring these guys up and, you know, say Leonis Martin, you know, put him on the trade block, see what you can get for him, because you can get something for him. You know what I mean? Whether it's a prospect, whether it's a pitcher, whether it's, you know, a young guy, whatever. I don't know exactly what's out there as far as the, you know, the Indians prospects. I'm quite frankly, I'm thinking the Indians' best case scenario is they're going to be a wild card team. They're going to have the one game playoff, and I'm not sure that. And again, who do you roll out there? Because you'll be just getting Kluber back. You'll be just getting, you know, do you put Bauer out there? I mean, it's an interesting question. Looking at your pitchers,
or you got Clevinger who came back. You know, you got. And actually, you're getting some good pitching from Bieber and some of the young guys.
Yeah, you are. I mean, you're the Indian strength is definitely pitching. You know, when we flip it over to my team, the Tigers, pitching is probably the least amount of their concerns. But, you know, I think the Indians have an opportunity to be a wild card team unless, again, something crazy happens with Minnesota. It's just no one expected Minnesota, but they're playing good ball. They're playing solid ball. They haven't been bit by the injury bug too much. I think the Indians have really, like, I think the injuries this year have, whatever plan the Tribe had going in has been put to the side because of injuries. It's really been affected.
Yeah, and I mean, that's the one thing that's been hurting them. And they have been holding on, and I think that's the thing. Once they get, you know, some of their pitching back, Kluber, I don't think he's going to – He might come back in August, but I mean, that's a long time without pitching.
He can't even grip a baseball at this point.
I wouldn't rely on him to come back and be strong, especially the way he was pitching. Even in the beginning, he was struggling a little bit for the Indians. But you get Clevinger back, Bieber's been solid, and you know, the Indians have had other players actually step it up pretty nicely. Zach Plesac is a guy that is a rookie this year, and he's had almost three or four good starts. He had one that, you know, he lost, but it wasn't a terrible start. He gave up some runs, but right now the Indians are actually ranked sixth in ERA. But
at what point? And here's another question for you as an Indians fan, and I think to all of our fans: at what point do you pull the plug on Jason Kipnis?
Well, and you know what? That's funny you say that, because Kipnis, hitting wise, has actually come along. He had two home runs last night. I think he had another few hits today. And his batting average, which was at like low 200 to come into the game, has all of a sudden risen up a little bit. And let's see if I can get his stats up here. But, you know, he's
but
a guy.
But that's not sustainable. He's not, I mean, look.
And that's yeah, he's 32 years old. He's in his eighth season. He's making over $14 million a year. I mean, Lindor makes less than he does.
Well, but Lindor is also significantly younger and is basically going to be able to – I mean, he's got two more years.
Yeah, Lindor is 7 years younger. You know, and that's going to be interesting to see what happens with
– I just don't know, man. I look at Kipnis, I look at a guy who's just like – he's a Mike Napoli character to me. You know what I mean? He's the guy in the locker room. And it's sad to say that because he was a great player. He still is a good player.
Well, he was a solid player. He's had a few rough years where he just hasn't.
Well, injuries have really
injuries
him
and he hasn't been great. But coming on, he's been coming along a little bit here into the season as the season has gone along a little bit hitting wise. But like I said, you know, you're not going to probably get much for him. You know, if you try to trade him, I mean, there's no doubt you're not gonna get too much for him. But, you know, I guess they're probably just gonna ride it out and see what happens. I mean, that's all you can do at this point. And the Indians have young players, and you know, a guy like Jose Ramirez, who had two solid seasons now, has really got into a hitting funk and still hasn't climbed out of it. You need him to come along. Carlos Santana's been a nice surprise this season, you know, the way he's batted, and he's been on a roll.
Given who they traded him for and who is now leading the league in home runs.
Yeah. Well, he got shipped to the Yankees. So now he's on the Yankees as Edwin Encarnacion.
Yeah, and I'm sure he's real beat up about that, having to bat behind Gary Sanchez and Aaron Judge who's coming back and, you know, all those guys. And Giancarlo Stanton, who's going to be back in a couple weeks or is probably back. Yeah, I'm sure he's real broken up about leaving Seattle, where he was where he was the best hitter. That's really going to affect him. That short ball field in the Bronx.
It's surprising. His batting average has been pretty solid because the last few years with the Indians, he puts up a lot of home runs, and he also gets a lot of RBIs. But one thing he doesn't, his batting average is, you know, usually 240s, and that's kind of what when you look at
he's a career 240 hitter.
Yeah, and that's what Carlos Santana has been, but this year he's hitting a lot better.
He's got a lot more pop, Santana does, and I think he's also, you know, he benefits from having guys like Lindor and Jose Ramirez back in the lineup because, you know, to a lot of the pitchers' credit, they're pitching away from Jose Ramirez is what I've noticed. I mean, they're trying to not – because he's a pull hitter, and he wants to pull the ball, and he does that. Whereas Lindor makes contact, gets on base, and that's what he's there for. But, you know, Carlos Santana is a guy that can do both. He can hit for contact, but he's also a power hitter, and he can go he can go outfield if he wants. And it's interesting to watch his at-bats because a lot of pitchers, you know, lefty or righty, tend to have a problem with him. You know, especially anything within low and away in the zone, which is I think is where he's maybe I got that wrong, but you know, he's very dangerous there, and pitchers can kind of play him a little. But also, they have to remember that, you know, usually in that same lineup is then Lindor, is Ramirez, now these young buck coming in, Mercado, Bowers, you know, Kipnis, who, you know, like you said, is batting well. You know, you wonder if that's sustainable. You hope it is. You really do. I mean, if you're an Indians fan, your best case scenario is that Kipnis continues this throughout the year and, you know, makes an all-star appearance or something like that. But I doubt that's going to happen. You know, it's interesting, man. And I watched – and the only reason I have so many opinions about the Indians is because local radio is just losing their mind about the Indians and what they're going to do.
And that's what I don't understand.
I'm just like, guys, this team was never built. This team had an opportunity – The AL Central was open for anybody to take it. Any good team who could put together a consistent run in the AL Central can have that title or can have the lead. The Twins have done it. The Indians had injuries, and they gave away a lot of good players, a lot of good offense that they just couldn't afford. You can't afford Michael Brantley. You can't, the talent-wise. You couldn't afford – I mean, you had Edwin Encarnacion, but it was a cap hit. If you want guys like Frankie Lindor to stay, you got to pay him. And if you don't pay him, they go. And that's just the nature of the beast. So you have to create space where there's space to be available. It makes more financial sense to the Dolans to have three guys in the outfield making less than your best player now, which is what's currently happening. You know what I mean? Like, their best case scenario is what you just laid out. Bowers, Bradley, and Mercado in the outfield, and all those guys making less than, you know, Lindor, Ramirez, and Santana. And producing at a better level. That's the best case scenario for the Dolans because they're getting more bang for their buck, and that's what they want. But they're never going to be – I mean, the Indians are never going to be a team that is listed as in the hunt for a big-time free agent. They're just never going to be. They don't have – unless they're bought out by somebody who has the money to throw away on players, I don't see it happening. Do you? I mean, do you honestly think that you have the same – you're the same ammo in your gun as a Yankees, as a Red Sox, as a Dodgers, as a Houston Astros.
No.
You don't.
No, but the only thing I can say is if these young players continue to grow throughout the year and Oscar Mercado continues on the trend he's going, I mean, some of these guys might develop into superstar players. You just don't know, but that's the risk you take. And I think it's funny when you talk about Cleveland radio, all these guys are talking about the Indians are – I mean, they've been talking about the Indians being out of it, you know, a long time ago. I mean,
Rob, it's June and they're 10 games back and they're barely –
they're 9.5 right now.
Yeah, but they're barely holding on to a wild card spot.
Okay.
We're not even to the All-Star break, and now you have to wonder, are you – but it's a valid question to ask. Are they so far back in the Central – and is the wild card that big of a deal? Because here's the deal. You're only guaranteed one game in a wild card. Anything
yeah.
can happen. And we've seen it
yeah.
here in Cleveland. You know what I mean? So are you going to sell the farm to maybe get a wild card? Or are you going to say, look, for whatever reason, it didn't work this year. Let's focus on next year after thing, sustainability for this franchise that – doesn't put you in the hurt locker as far as cap space is concerned, as far as luxury tax, as far as, you know, all that stuff that, frankly, teams like New York, Boston, L.A., Philly, the Phillies, the Nationals, they can all afford it because they're big markets. Cleveland's not a big market. It's not. It never has been, never will be. But it's also one of the things where the Indians were supposed – this was part of that window that everyone talked about.
Yeah.
And this is the – but I think this was the beginning of the end of that window. 2016 was at its zenith. You guys did everything you could. You got a 3-1 lead in the World Series, and you couldn't close it out. No one talks about that because it's the greatest comeback for the Cubs. But you had a 3-1 lead and two games at home, and you didn't get it done. Ed and Josh can yell and call me a jerk all they want, but you know what? The Tigers – to their credit, never blew a 3-1 lead in the World Series. The Indians have. They did. You had an opportunity to win. You had two games at home. You couldn't convert. A lot of that has to do with the Cubs being as talented as they were. A lot of that had to do with the injuries to the pitching staff. Whatever. You still had an opportunity. 2016 was your opportunity. Last year, 2017, 2018, you had a shot. But guess what? You didn't have the offensive firepower. Or you didn't have them clicking at the same time. You got swept by the Yankees twice. In the first round of the playoffs, the decline was there.
Yeah, and that's the thing. I mean,
you can't expect a small market team to keep guys on a payroll for peanuts, and that's what it is when you compare Edwin Encarnacion, Michael Brantley. They went places for money. I mean, Edwin Encarnacion was traded.
Well, Michael Brantley actually is only making about 13 or 14 million a year, which is a good amount, but for what he's doing, the Indians. You know, instead are still, and this blows my mind, you know, you're paying Jason Kipnis $14 million. I mean, at some point, maybe they could have cut bait and kept Brantley. You're also paying Danny Salazar, who hasn't pitched in 3 years. He's making $5 million this year,
but he
probably won't see the field at all this year.
But that's all based on a contract that he signed 5 years ago.
No, he just signed it, like, I think it was last year. Because I was still scratching my head. A young pitcher that –
I'm talking about Kipnis, not Salazar.
Oh, Kipnis is signed, yeah.
That's the same argument I bring up with Miguel Cabrera. But Miguel Cabrera is still on a deal that he signed almost 5, 6, 7 years ago. So you can't really blame them for doing that with Kipnis because at that point in time, Kipnis was one of their best players. He was part of that core group. And again, injuries have hurt him over the last couple of years. Salazar – I want to say that they thought he was going to turn out better, but again, we don't know what's going on with Danny Salazar. It's not necessarily like the end all be all, but he's.
Well, I will say the Indians. One thing they always have done is if they're a young player and they have a good year, you know, they try to take a gamble and say, you know, I'm sure talking to the coaches and say, do you think this can be sustainable? Let's offer him a 4-year deal. And that's why they had Kluber. That's why they have Carrasco. That's why they have all the pitchers signed up for long-term deals at really good rates is because they show signs that they can have a good year. And then they take a gamble and they sign players to 4-year deals. And Kipnis was one of those guys that maybe just didn't work out. But you look at some of the other players, You know, Ramirez was a guy they signed, you know, first, and he had two good years. Now he's having a down year. But they signed a lot of these guys to long-term deals when they show that they have, you know, one good year, and they take a chance. And sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. For Kipnis, you know, that really hasn't panned out. But for a lot of others, it has. So that's, you know, in a small market team, that's the gamble you take. And it's worked for the Indians for the most part because they've sustained division championships the last, what, 3 years now. So,
yeah,
you know, but eventually, you know, it could bite you in the butt, you know, and we'll see what happens in the rest of this season.
I really think that the Indians are probably going to be sellers come the trade deadline.
If
I
they
think,
get a deal that they can't refuse, I completely agree, for I Bowers think, or Hand, and I wouldn't mind doing it. But, I mean, if it's a deal where
I think trading,
you're getting single A guys, I mean, that to me.
But, again, you're trading Trevor Bauer because there's nothing guaranteed with him. It's almost one of those situations where you got a player who's not committing to you. He's a free agent after next year, so why not capitalize? It's the same thing we saw with Anthony Davis. David Griffin said, look, I got to get something. I can strike while the iron's hot now, or I can wait to be holding the bag and get nothing for him. Trevor Bauer is that situation for the Indians right now. If he's not willing to commit long term, if they can't come to terms on an extension, and he says, I just want to do 1 year contracts with me, you just want to be a merc, then that's fine. Go do that with another team. We're going to trade you and get the best we can back there. That's what the Indians should do with Trevor Bauer. Brad Hand, that's the one where you got to say, look, everybody in the world needs a closer that with Brad Hand's consistency, and how much are they willing to pay through the nose on that? And if I'm the Indians, I'm holding them hostage for what they want for Brad Hand. It better be top-tier prospects. It better be cash reserves. It better be all kinds of stuff for Brad Hand, because that's the guy you're going to make your money on. That's the guy you're going to make get the true value on if you decide to trade him. If not,
yeah,
then so what? You got him for another couple years.
Yeah, and that's what I'm interested to see what's going to happen is – like you said, you got to keep an eye on what can the Indians do after the All-Star break. There is time before the trade deadline to see if they're going to buy or sell. I think there should be probably a clear indication on what they're going to do at that point.
But again, I also look at their schedule, and then the reason I brought that up is that they're not really playing between – I guess I read somewhere, I heard on the radio, somewhere between like now and the trade deadline, they're not playing a team over 500 except for like once. I think there's like a throwaway with Tampa Bay or something like that. But like in that stretch, you got to wonder if they take care of business and they beat the teams they're supposed to beat, but they're not playing top tier teams. You see what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
Is it almost, you know, the numbers are bearing out a false positive here. You see what I'm saying? Like, is it saying we're doing great, we're on the right track, but really you're just playing inferior competition as soon as you get to say August or in a playoff hunt or something like that, when you're playing teams like right now Minnesota or Houston or New York or, you know, whoever, Boston or whoever, you know, are you then saying because you didn't do anything or because you sold the farm, now you're robbing Peter to pay Paul? I mean, it's hard to tell, obviously.
Yeah.
That's why, but it's a question to think about as Indians fans. But again, I think the Indians fans also need to measure their respective, you know, collective expectations right now. This team is not a very consistently offensive team right now. In the short term, they have been, and that's perfect for them. But I'm telling you, this team is not as far from a finished product, in my opinion, as far as their lineup is concerned. You get a healthy rotation, and that covers up a lot of the mistakes and a lot of the holes for a lineup that can't produce because you have great pitching. But what we're seeing now is a lot of those weaknesses are being exposed, and they're being shown because that pitching staff is not healthy, and they're relying more on the offense, which really, aside from guys like Ramirez, Santana, and all those guys, they're not producing a lot. I mean, they are now, but again, they're not playing anybody that's really blown up the defensive side, but we'll see.
Yeah, and that's can they sustain – what they've been doing offensively? They've been putting up more runs. The pitching has come up and played a lot better. And we'll have to wait and see.
Can we just get the Brown season?
I know. That's what everybody wants. And you know, one thing for everybody that's listening, I mean, go at SOT Podcast on Twitter. We're on Facebook. Our YouTube page archives all of our podcasts. Come late August, we're going to have preview shows from high school sports, High school football is going to be huge this year. Obviously, we'll be all over the place with our game of the week, and we'll give the updates on our show, the recaps. Also, hockey season, once that comes back around. We're going to be doing some fun things coming up, so make sure you keep an eye on our website, and also here our website is sportsontappodcast.com. We're all over social media, so get involved with the show. But, Sean, great discussion on the Indians. I think we a lot of different options. I'm interested to see which way they go.
I want to point it out.
Yeah, you're an Indians fan.
No,
that's
I'm not.
Right.
I'm really not. I just have a lot of opinions on it. But I didn't come at you as, you know, Indians are terrible. They're not, but they're not. They're not
ripping it up either.
They're not gonna, they're not in a position to be talked about with the top teams in the league right now. They're
not right now. No, not. Absolutely not.
And I would be saying it right now that a wild card spot is probably the best they can hope for, given where they're at. I mean, just given where, one, the competition is in the AL Central, and two, where the league is, the American League, essentially. But
yeah, we'll wait and see. It's a long season, but hopefully they can keep grinding it out and keep the bats rocking and rolling. And right now in the NBA draft, Zion Williamson went number one to the Pelicans. The Grizzlies selected Ja Morant at number two from Murray State. The Knicks, took R.J. Barrett out of Duke. The Lakers, who had that trade to Atlanta, took DeAndre Hunter, a forward, out of Virginia. And the Cavs, they took Darius Garland, the point guard, out of Vanderbilt, only played five games. The Suns, their trade to Minnesota, so as the Minnesota Timberwolves took Jared Culver out of Texas Tech. The Chicago Bulls took Kobe White, the point guard, out of North Carolina. The Hawks, they took Jackson Hayes, the center, out of Texas. That would go to the Pelicans. The Washington Wizards at nine took Rui Hachimura, a power forward, out of Gonzaga. And the Hawks took Cam Reddish out of Duke. So those are the top 10 selections in the NBA draft. Any last thoughts, Sean, before we close down the show?
Yeah, just one last thing.
Oh, no.
One more thing. I think you would agree with me here. You know, Josh Jeffy, he's working hard. He really is.
He's working really hard.
He's a hard-working kid.
Kid. Yeah, we should say congratulations to somebody, too. All right, go ahead. I want to hear what you're going to say about Josh Jeffy.
I was going to say he's a hard-working kid, and it must have been terrible watching his Boston Bruins kid get smoked in Game 7 at home. How do you lose at the Garden, kid? How does Rask give up four, kid?
I thought we did a great job today and, you know, going over everything. NBA draft, the Indians.
I thought we did a great job today, too, buddy.
We always do a great job.
Yeah. I think we did a fantastic job. Let's see what the
fans see what everybody else say. That's the real question.
Let's let you two be the judge of that.
But yeah, great job here at RRT Productions Studios. Sean, I think is about to call quits here.
I'm done. Fill me up and I'm done, kid.
All right, nice job tonight, and we'll be back at it again soon.
Yep. A lot of big things coming our this way. So
yeah, we got a lot going on, and it's gonna be a good time. So for Sean Duffy,
wait,
for Ed Dick,
yes,
Josh Jeffy, who's might be still working to make sure Lake Erie stays clean, stays fresh. Again, the Cavaliers draft Darius Garland, point guard, out of Vanderbilt with their pick. Had a great discussion about the Cleveland Indians. Go to our YouTube page. We're at SOT Podcast on Twitter, Facebook. We're also on Instagram if you want to go there. SportsOnTapPodcast.com is our website where you can catch everything that we talk about. Want to thank our sponsors, GV Artwork. If you want GV Artwork shirts, you go there. They have great shirts that they design. You get put on tap 10 and you get 10% off on everything that you order there. So make sure you type that in and tell them Sports on Tap sent you. Go to RRT Productions has been a sponsor. Z's Cream and Bean, we're hoping to get back there soon.
Yeah, I need some milkshake.
Oh, man, I miss their milkshakes and ice cream. It's a perfect time. The summer is right around the corner, or actually it's coming up tomorrow. It's officially summer. G&G Fitness, want to thank them for being part of all of our shows. They always do a great job. If you have a coach that you want to be our coach of the week, when we when we get started with football season in our high school sports. Nominate your coach by going to livefit.com. That's G&G Fitness, livefit.com. All right, we're Sports on Tap. I want to thank everyone for listening. For Sean Duffy, I'm Rob Troutman. We'll see you later. Thanks for listening. Have a great weekend, everyone. Bye.